Okay, so let me just, quickly address everybody who has joined in this masterclass, joined us in the masterclass meeting. Welcome everybody to another very, very exciting masterclass, and thank you so much for showing initiative, participation. We are overwhelmed because we are already at 101 participants who are here with us. We had about almost 275 registrations. And let's hope that in the due course of the session, everybody can join in and have some key learning takeaways, which they can apply to their organization, their skills, their roles, and their industries. I know personally that one of our speakers, Chitra, and I, we both support women a lot. So it would be lovely to have more women participation in this masterclass, as well as in future as well. We have two speakers with us and panelists with us already. I also have my organizing team, collaborative team, managing director here with me on this session, Mr. Amit Kapoor. Thank you, Amit, for sparing the time to be with us here and making this possible.
Thanks a lot, Eva.
What we're going to do is we're going to hear from everybody. Just to let you all know that we have actually muted everybody because we are going to be so many of us, more than 100. It is in the interest of a smooth flow that we will have the video and the audio muted. So hope you bear with us. We have your consideration. We also have another speaker who has joined us, Sunil.
Hi. Hi, Divya.
Hello, we can see you looking bright and very, very relaxed on a weekend.
Thank you. Thank you.
So great. I think we still have people joining in, and my team is gonna let them in. But in the interest of time, we are slightly 10 minutes late, so I'm gonna hold on to all the speakers and participants for another 10 minutes because we didn't start exactly at 11. I hope the speakers are fine with that.
Perfect.
Great. Okay, so I'm going to just unmute all the speakers. And speakers, I think you have the liberty of unmuting yourselves. For all those who have recently joined, I'm Dr. Divya Jetley. On behalf of the Advanced Learning Institute, powered by Forethought Corporate Communications and in collaboration with Elements HR, New Delhi, I'm very, very happy and excited and delighted to welcome you all. Thank you so much for making time for us on a Saturday. I know the weekend has just started, and we all are working from home. And to keep your focus and a learning objective surrounded by your loved ones, I know it needs a lot of grit and determination. In the interest of a flawless execution of this masterclass session, I have muted all of you, the audio and video. Only the speakers have the privilege of actually being visible to all of us, as well as sharing their thoughts with us. So I'm going to request you, for those of you who still have your cameras on, please remove your camera feed so that we can see all of your names. If there are any comments, feedback, suggestions, or any technical difficulties, feel free to write it in our chat window. My technical team is very, very able to help you, giving you a back-end support. We'll try our best. With that, I'm going to begin this masterclass and keep letting people in. To all the speakers, we have 104 participants right now. So this is actually the power of all of your presence, that people want to hear from you, the insights from your experiences over the years that you have, understood and learned about leadership and change management. Before I get into introducing the speakers and also setting a little bit of a context, I'm going to quickly thank Elements HR and Vastory. They are a leading recruitment firm in India, and they have supported us in partnering with us for this masterclass. The Advanced Learning Institute keeps holding masterclasses in the topics that interest you, which are relevant to today's business scenario. And this time, we actually doubled our power by collaborating with the recruitment firm, because the only way to be ahead of the curve is obviously keeping the learning curve high, as well as upskilling ourselves. So this is our unique way, and I'm gonna just move on to the next slide. So my dear friends, you know, not that I'm very able as the speakers, and you're gonna hear from them, but I have, you know, 2 decades of my own career, and what I learned about change management from across industries is that 54% of change initiatives actually fail. And this I'm talking with context to the Indian business landscape. And they are failing, number one, because we are not addressing or raising the right questions. They are failing because maybe we are making too many change initiatives simultaneously in an organization as the business leader. Now, I thought, how can we change that? And what have I learned with my experiences from media, from corporate, from education industries? I realized that these 6 questions, if we ask ourselves, or if these questions are asked to our senior management where we work, or to our employees and our team members, if we are an entrepreneur, they will help us drive change management initiatives in the right direction. And hopefully we'll be able to bring down the percentage of failure of 54% in the coming years. These are unprecedented times. I mean, this global pandemic has shook us all. And please do not mistake that this has affected only the small organizations. I'm consulting with many organizations, and trust me, it doesn't matter what size of the organization it has been. Small, medium, large, everybody has been impacted in one way or the other. Now, if this is the scenario, then what are these 6 questions that we can ask? And I'm just going to leave this food for thought with all of you. And these are just my learnings, my opinions. Feel free to differ. Feel free to write your comments, feedback, and add questions or add points that we need to ask. So the first one is obviously, when a change request is raised, either due to internal or external factors, the first question we need to ask is, what is the reason behind it? Why is it happening? What are the risks which are entailing in this change management process? What kind of a relationship can we have during the process of change with our internal and external customers? What sort of responsibility are we going to showcase or delegate when it comes to this change management process? What kind of resources do we need to give away, or we need to impart to the right change drivers within an organization so that it can enable them or facilitate them to take this change forward? And who is going to return us from this change? Now, that is a very crucial question, because as a leader, you are closely associated with the process of change management in any organization. I would say it's not just an organization. Some of you who have logged in and who are participating in this meeting with us, in this webinar with us, will also relate that even if you're an independent contractor, even if you are an independent consultant, we all think that we have to bounce back from change. In larger teams, who is going to return to you? Which is the leader that you can look up to? And what are those qualities that you can imbibe from? So these are just 6 questions which I thought I should share with you. And let's quickly move forward. Amit, at this point, I'm going to bring you in here. For those of you who've just recently joined, Amit Kapoor is the founder and managing director for Elements HR Services and VastStory. And he leads a leading recruitment firm in India. Amit, how can we navigate through change? If briefly, you can quickly summarize it for us.
First of all, thank you, Divya, for your lovely introduction and inviting me for today's masterclass. And definitely, it is a delight to collaborate Elements and VastStory with Tali and Forethoughts to facilitate this event today. Good morning to all the audience right now, and a warm welcome to our esteemed panelists, Avtar, Chitra, and Sunil. Definitely, it is an honor to have you here. I think that the interesting fact, right, I being an entrepreneur and my journey, I think has no less than a roller coaster ride, right? And change is one element which I feel has been constant throughout my entire journey. And there is a very interesting fact that I would talk about when you are being an entrepreneur and you've been kind of running your own business. That one side, when you keep exploring the way for boosting your own revenues from your client, on the flip side of it, the clients have been studying the avenues to switch their dependency from us to save their cost as well. So that is always probably keep us on our toes. And the only option that we left with is to evolve and always strive to provide a value add to our client. And I think so. Let's come back to your question, which is like decoding navigation through change. And I think that the current time, as you just mentioned, the current time is the most ambiguous time that we are experiencing globally. And definitely it has a new flavor and a variety. But since COVID-19 pandemic continues to evolve, now I think that this is the time that we need to shift our focus to effort that support a return to work. Because I think that's something which is a next change which is required. And here's how organization can begin making that shift from mobilizing during this time to stabilizing into the new environment and strategizing for what's next. And I think that as you just mentioned about it, I think that most of the organizations are going through a lot of changes at this point of time, and they've realized that how important change is. One of the biggest job of a leader is to navigate their team through this change, this time period right now, and the change process. And with my experience to run a successful change, I break the process into four different phases that occur parallelly. So the first phase that I would talk about is discover. I think that change begins with understanding, right? A leader should have a clear understanding of why change is necessary and what will happen if you stay on the same path. Will you continue to lose profit shares? Is there?
Yes. Somebody's audio is on. Okay. Just give me a minute. Let me again mute all. Please mute your audio if you're listening to me. I did mute all. I think this is one of the recent joinees. Amit, continue. I'm going to try and fix this at the back end. Yes.
Okay. So as I've just started off, that discover is one of the phases to begin change. And I think that as I've just mentioned about it, that it continues because it is important to kind of understand why change is necessary. And any leader should have clear understanding about that. We should have this understanding that with you, if in case any outbreak like COVID-19 will force you to switch to your product or service line completely. So it is imperative for an organization's leader to have clarity and are in alignment with their responses to a couple of other questions, right? That what is the need of the change? And will it be evolutionary or revolutionary in nature? What is the scope? What is the urgency, or what communities, stakeholders, groups, change agents need to be taken into consideration? How are the people leading the change and who are the people leading the change that are aligned and committed or not? So, and what is the level of their commitment? I think that once we would have answer for these questions, I think we'll be able to go ahead and through with the first phase. Right? The second phase that I talk about is decide, right? So when the vision is formed and the change train is mapped, the plans are created, the core team and the early adopter begin to engage employees in decisions about the change. And at this stage, deciding about how to frame the change initiative or building relationships or motivating others or creating alignment and commitment, these are some key, I think that attributes the leadership should have. Right. The third phase that I talk about is discern. And as we know, that change may continue and solidify, or it may be a possibility, it may fall off, fail, or take a hold. Right. So change leaders must discern what is working and what isn't in order to kind of maintain focus, energy, resource, and support to ensure change sustained over a time period. So we all believe in that we all are the product of our decision. And yet rarely we consider the consequences of making a wrong one, right? So decision-making skills often fall by a wayside, right? To allow successful change management to occur with the business, I think a leader must take a right decision, even when it is a challenging time period. And the last phase that I divide the entire change process into do. So when communicating and taking steps to enact the change begins, the rollout may be slow or a fast pace, but leaders should recognize that no matter how quickly you choose to move, people still need time to adapt change, because change leaders must show commitment to the change initiative and above all, to all the people who are affected by the change. Because I think that cracking the code of change is an emotional undertaking, and which requires relationship building across the entire interrelated web of change agents and people who are impacted. So over the time with you, with diligence, generosity, and courage, these four phases for navigating change can be mastered at every turn of the road, right? And if you are a leader, you'll get plenty of opportunities to practice. I think that that is what my take is. And this is what exactly that how I felt the change has to be divided into four different phases.
Great. No, that is very, very informative. And I think all the people who've joined us here, we have 104 attendees in this session right now. I love these hacks, you know. So I think if I have to summarize, Amit has given you four D's of navigating through different phases. And it was very, very informative, Amit, from your experience. And I have given you 6 R's with summarize the right questions that you need to ask your organizations, yourself, the moment a request for change is given. Now, this is just from us. And now we need to get into the speaker space and get to hear from their experiences, what they've learned across industries about change management. Moving on, friends, our first panelist and our first guest speaker today, I've known him for 15 years now. I think we met each other on a flight to Udaipur. And over the years, I've looked up to him as a mentor, as an advisor, and we've stayed connected. It is my privilege and honor to welcome here Mr. Sunil Dutt, President Devices, Sales and Distribution, Reliance Jio Infocom Limited. For those of you who are not familiar with his credentials, allow me a few minutes to summarize it. I'll try and put it in few lines as possible. He's got 30 years plus experience in consumer and tech industry. He has been the managing director for BlackBerry India, president for PSG Hewlett Packard, country head for Samsung India, director sales for Nokia India, and he's also worked with many brands such as Barista, Whirlpool, Wipro, and Philips India. So it is definitely a privilege to welcome here none other than Sunil Dutt. I'm going to bring him here live for everybody. And Sunil, if you can just address all our viewers at this point.
Thank you. Thank you for that introduction, Divya. You're very kind with your words. And yes, I think it's been a little more than 15 years that we met. And yep. So pleasure to be here. And first and foremost, I do hope everybody on the call and you know your loved ones, you're all taking care of yourselves. Because COVID-19 has not gone away anywhere. It's still around. It's very much there. And it's a pretty smart virus. I mean, it knows its job. So so I hope you're being smarter than the virus and taking care of yourselves, all of you. So stay safe, each and every one of you. You know, in terms of, change management, I mean, it's a pretty broad term. You know, change management, because if I was to look at it one way, change management is in our daily lives. I mean, it's starting from whether it's our homes or whether it's our work, whether it's our interpersonal relationships. It's all there's change management everywhere. So, some of the points that I think we were discussing in terms of what can be the possible challenges, to change management. and what exactly is change management. So any situation which requires either a different response or a different strategy to achieve an objective or an outcome, which is strategically important, either for your organization or for yourself, or even in your personal lives, that requires a certain amount of change management. So we actually live with it on a daily basis. It's not something that we come to as a particular project. I mean, there are projects, definitely, but we live with change management on a daily basis. So if you have to just look within, I mean, we'll discover that there are, several aspects in our life which we, which we handle as a change. And there are challenges to change management. Let me just spend a few minutes on that. And why are there challenges? Because people have different perspective in their lives. And people have different perspectives in their life because of their experience, because of their knowledge, because of the way of working, and maybe comfort in the way of working or doing things. So that can be a challenge for change management to be sort of driven. Aligning everybody to change brings different issues to be handled by different people. That's another challenge that one encounters for change management. So therefore, I feel that, even as Amit posed, it's extremely important to have clarity in communication for what is the reason for change, what are the benefit it brings to everybody, what are the benefits brings to people, what are the benefits it brings to processes, what benefits for the business, for the growth, for the jobs, and so on. So one needs to have a clear thought process as well as clarity in the communication for what the change is going to bring about. Then I believe, the important part is about handling objections and questions in a very objective manner. That's where a lot of leaders sometimes fail, when their own personal belief makes it a subjective response, or brings out a subjective response to a very objective question or a concern or an issue raised by people. So handling objections and handling questions in a very objective manner becomes extremely important, because a lot of questions come from emotions. Whenever, we are trying to impact a change, there are emotions which get evolved. There are emotions which come out. There are emotions which get manifested in the questions or in the objections. So that always is challenging to handle. And therefore, if the responses are objective, if they're factual, fact-based, if we articulate them in a fact-based manner, then one, it is easier for the people driving the change to make it more acceptable. And of course, it becomes more acceptable to the people as well. So I would say, change in that sense is something that we all live with on a daily basis. How do we drive it? How do we, overcome some of those things? Let's hear some of the other speakers, and then maybe Divya, we can come back to it if it's okay.
Absolutely, Sunil. Thank you so much for giving us a great opening address here with your thoughts on change and highlighting challenges of change management. Of course, what we had done, let me tell all the speakers and the attendees here that we had reached out to everybody for questions, and you'll be surprised that the amount of questions that have poured in for each one of your industries. So I have the list right here. I'm going to quickly go to our next speaker to introduce her, Chitra Shingare. Of course, Avtar, ladies first. Let me bring her in.
Absolutely fine. Though you said that two of us believe, I said we also believe to have the ladies in the priority list.
Yes. So I'm going to bring Chitra in here. Great. Ladies and gentlemen, we have Chitra Shingare here with us. She has been the former managing director for JP Morgan Chase and the Deutsche Bank. She is belonging to the C-suite of the banking and capital markets. She is IICA qualified independent director with the Ministry of Corporate Affairs. She's a member of Harvard Square Leaders Excellence Forum. She's also been nominated very recently on the board of the ISEX as the Public Interest Director, Indian Commodity Exchange. Oh my God, I can go on and on, but I'm getting goosebumps because very rarely you find women with such credentials in the C-suite. Welcome, Chitra.
Okay, hi.
Yes. We can hear you now. Okay. Welcome to the masterclass.
Thank you. So good morning, and thank you, Amit and Divya, for having me, and a very good morning to Sunil and Avtar. They are the thespians in the industry, right? So it's August company for me. Thanks for having me, and I'm really honored to be part of this program. So, no, I don't believe in ladies first, Avtar. So, you know, I believe in equality. I didn't want to be put on the second slot. I should have been on the last slot, but never mind. Now that you've already brought me in, but believe me, I'm not one of those high on diversity and, you know, women agenda proportional. I believe in equality, and I've grown in my career only because of, you know, being equal in every part of my life. Whether it's
you need to talk offline to Devia. I have no problem with either of these.
Okay. So I believe in equality, sir, so no problem. Okay, change is only constant, right, in life. And, you know, who ever thought last year this time that we would be impacted by COVID? None of us, right? None of the astrologers could predict. None of the so-called, the predictors of economy could ever say that we're going to be impacted by such a pandemic. So change is the only constant. And I take this pandemic also as a change that has impacted the whole universe. So coming back from my industry, right, I've been a banker for, over 26 years. So it's natural that I'll speak more about my industry. So change is the only constant. And, you know, the wings of transformation are born out of patience and struggle. The path is a little difficult, but the purpose is definitely bigger. The secret of change is to focus not on the old, but try on building on the new. And that's exactly what had helped most of us in our banking and capital market industry to actually start. So change is something that happened to us every day. There are reforms every day. There are changes happening to processes and to regulation every day. So it's a complete constant. It's something that we're always open to. I mean, we've tuned to it. We've attuned to it now to get accustomed to, you know, things coming and hitting us almost on a daily basis. And what I have encountered is that each time, a change has been kind of initiated, be it a restructuring or be it a process change, be it a regulatory change, that's something that is on a daily basis. The best thing is to just adapt to it, right? And what I did as a leader, or what my organizations helped me do or helped us do as leaders and teams, is that they got us onto a platform where we had a separate, set up a separate change management and transformation team. Now, this actually happens to be a center of excellence within the organization where any change that needs to happen, be it to the process, people, whatever you may have, it kind of gets structured in a very, in a very systematic fashion. And then, we call it the center of excellence, and, we have the best people working on it. And it is actually a team of people who are all going to work toward bringing about the change. So be it the IT, be it the process guys, be it the risk management team, the compliance team, external vendors with whom we work. So that's something that has helped us to kind of, adapt and bring out the changes in the record time that we need to do, because we belong to the banking industry. And that, I think, has kind of helped us. So none of us come wearing the hat of a change manager, right? You adapt, you grow, you learn, you imbibe, and you execute.
Right.
That's a little bit too big from me.
Well said, Chitra. I think you summarized it very well and laid the foundation of a discussion coming up. And in the interest and the spirit of parity, guess what? A lot of women leaders' questions are going to come your way, because women deal with change in a very different manner than how men do in the business world, right? So
Yeah.
I'm going to move on to introducing our next speaker so that we can quickly get into a discussion mode. And it is important for me to highlight Mr. Avtar Monga, because today he's not just going to be representing, you know, insights and answers from the Indian business scenario and being a leader himself from the corporates, but also helping startups, because we do have a lot of entrepreneurs in this session as well. And we want to make sure that we have message for everybody across. Mr. Avtar Monga currently is the managing partner for Stride Ventures, an angel investor, and he is mentoring and helping a lot of startups, not just in India, but also globally. He has had 38 years of experience, including financial, banking, and investing. Oh my God, are you older than Sunil Avtar?
Yes, I am.
Okay. I think you are youngest at heart. Let me put it that way.
I won't say no to that.
Okay, to continue his credentials, ladies and gentlemen, he spent over a decade with Bank of America, establishing and scaling their India and global delivery centers of expertise as managing director. He was with GE Capital's India management team, and he led its SBI Card joint venture and transport financial services business as its CEO. More recently, he has been the chief operating officer with the IDFC Bank. And of course, he's here with us today to help us understand, not just as a corporate person, as a self-independent consultant, self-employed, or as a startup owner, how we can overcome change, especially in these times of crisis. Avtar, over to you.
Thank you. A lot of expectation building, I must say. So I'll have to now do some justice to at least, you know, make sure that you're not proven wrong. So, you know, we all heard, the fundamentals of change and the change management, but I have a slightly different view. So change is constant, Chitra. I completely agree. And I also agree, Sunil, that change is everyday life. It's not an event which takes once in a while. And, simplest example is you all take the same route to office every morning, but there are times when you have to get diverted. And many times you'll agree that that small diversion in a city where you live actually is a painful change for you, because you did not expect it to come up, because there's a barricade in the way and the cops have told you turn left and you've no choice there. But the point I'm going to make is slightly broader. I think the traditional definition of change, which we used to call change management, which is a more of a process by which the corporates try to move from a position A to position B, is what typically is called change management in the corporate jargon. There also, the fact is the definition of change in today's environment is very different. It is no longer something which is what a company would use to, you know, would say, this is, we manage change. Because now change is, so that change, the earlier change was more of a proactive change, that you had a mandate to do something and you were trying to do it in a systematic manner. The today's change is actually all driven by outside forces. So nobody expected COVID, and nobody knows what industries will be impacted by COVID. So if you take that, you know, view, the change of today's environment is more is a forced change. Given a choice, I will go to office, but the fact is I can't. Given a choice, I will go to a travel and stay in Italy for 15 days. Now, even if somebody was to give it free to me today, I will not go. So this is a very different world we are in. So what is changing in change is this, that historically it has been, barring the cultural change, which is again initiated change, it's not a forced change. Changes have been mostly led in the past either through the product changes, the process changes, technology changes, and those kind of, you know, principles. What is happening now is the change is actually happening because of the global change. For example, a simple example of that will be China getting barred from certain investment opportunities. I mean, it's a change which you didn't initiate, but if you're in the startup world, half your money is gone because you don't know where to go. And that itself is such a big change that you don't know how to react to that. The second example is what Chitra was talking about, that in banking, every day there's a circular from some regulator, SEBI, RBI, ROC, all of that. But those are normal changes. We don't worry about them. But the six-month moratorium is not a normal change, because that even systems are not configured. So that is a second form of. So there is a lot of change which we are having to deal with today, which is not actually a normal change management change. It's a disaster management change in my view. And it's not just negative, because there are industries even in this environment which are seeing it as a positive change. And my friend Sunil's company is one of them, right? So there is obviously both sides of change. It's not no for everything. It's a yes also for a lot of things. The other thing I want to say is that the other, you know, thing which is changing, which is because of these changes, there's another change which is taking place, which is the customer preferences are changing. I mean, I used to go and shop every day. I don't go at all, and I shop still, right? So there is another level of change which is happening, which is going to change the way the humans behave. I mean, this meeting is an example of that. When was it last time that you had 104 participants and three panelists and you on a Saturday morning, having this conversation? We would have been sitting in some five-star hotel in a hall and sipping coffee probably, right? So that's a big change. The other thing is the business model itself is changing. So one is the internal, the other is external. I mean, the aviation, the hospitality, the telecom, media in particular. So all this has changed. And these are all different changes. We'll talk about the impact of all this on the startup world in a Q&A session. But this actually requires a very different handling. So if you have to allow me to at least comment about certain behavioral part of what changes. Of course, managing has to be done, because this is part and parcel of ups and downs. So I was actually reflecting on what are the behavioral things which are more relevant, even more relevant today. They are relevant in nonetheless, always. You know, the emotional maturity, the awareness, the environment understanding, all those things are there. There are 5-6 things which have now emerged as more compelling leadership behaviors because of the environment and the change definition which has changed. So one thing is, there is a need for you to be authentic. And authentic basically means that you need to know what you're going to do. And I don't want to quote the companies where I worked, but, you know, very recently in the US, a very large bank CEO came on media and actually made a declaration that in our company, till end of the year, whether you're able to work from home or not able to work from home, there is going to be no layoff. Right? And this was not yesterday. This is 3 months back. So the point is, there is a clear clarity of thought saying, I will not let this happen. So that's one thing which today is more relevant, because sometimes this ambiguity is a bigger problem than the problem itself. And so that's the first thing. I think you need to also, in these environments, have a courageous leadership. And courage doesn't mean that you become a goon. It basically means that you have the ability to say, I must have this, or I must do this, I must not also do this. That it's both sides. It's not just saying yes. I think given the fact that the COVID has played an equalizer role, I mean, you know, frankly, earlier we used to have a question about who can afford to go to a Taj hotel and have lunch. Today, affordability doesn't matter. Nobody goes there. So in a way, we are all in the same boat. But what differentiates a leader today's environment from the rest of the world is somebody who's having empathy towards people who are his responsibility, her responsibility. And I'm not talking about sympathy here. I think today's environment, you need to have that understanding that whatever is happening has a lot of implications. And there are a lot of them which are not in your control, but there are some which are in your control. So when you do things or you don't do things, they will have an impact on a larger audience. So you need to know it is a very big responsibility. You just can't think of yourself and say, "Mera to theek hai, baaki kya farak padta hai." That's never the case in a leader, but today it's even more so. The other thing is communication. Because even if you're thinking something, if you don't tell, that thinking has no value. It's only when people know where you're going, they will follow you. If you are very clear where you're going, but you're not discussing and you're not communicating, I think somebody mentioned that. I think Sunil and Chitra both talked about the fact that communication in this environment is even more critical. You know, I'll tell you, in a home front, if somebody goes from home in the evening these days and doesn't show up or doesn't make a phone call for 4 hours, there is a tension. That's another level of communication, because you need to know if all is well. And we're talking about that, and Sunil actually started his comment with the idea saying, I hope all your families are well. It's an important part. And I'm not talking about only the health communication. I'm just saying that in the tough environment, communication is even more critical. So that's the other thing. And I think the final thing I'll say is you need to be trustworthy. The lesser the bullshit, the better the answers. There's no point hiding the problems. You have to openly discuss the problem with as much a larger audience as possible. So I think, and the last thing I'll say is this period also has taught us one other very interesting thing, that life is actually, we can manage life with half the money we always think is required. It's very frugal, because frankly, I haven't had a dinner with somebody for 4 months and I'm all right. Right? It used to be a weekly affair. So the point is, there are lots of teachings which this environment has brought to us. How much of that can be held on to for a longer period? How much of that actually gets into our system? And the one other side of this is also the fact that this period has taught us there are a lot of people who are not as lucky as us. And some of us have been trying to do something which is more meaningful for their, you know, lives. Maybe that should be a norm. That should not be a crisis management outcome. So there are a lot of those things. So to me, this is a very interesting period. And the good thing is this will also pass. So I'm very sure we all will emerge far clearer, stronger, and probably happier in the coming months. So I'll stop at that.
Great. Thank you, Avtar. Thank you so much. So many insights and things to, you know, think about. I love the aspect that you weaved in, that today's times, and especially change happening during today's times, is synonymous to crisis management or disaster management. And interestingly, how you've touched upon the relevance of socioeconomic status also as part of the change management process. At the Advanced Learning Institute, we are always driving as a change agent these talks and insights and discussions, because we want everybody to understand and learn from different worlds how we are all driving these change management processes, not just personally, but also professionally. So let's quickly get into the next phase of our meeting today, which is a panel discussion. Now, just to set a little bit of context for panel discussion, each speaker has built a foundation. You all are most welcome to send in your comments, queries, and feedback in the chat window. My team is constantly monitoring it. In fact, speakers, let me tell you, I already have a list of, you know, 7-8 questions here with me, and I have a list of 20 questions which people email to us prior to the start of this discussion. I'm going to quickly come to you, Sunil, and requesting all speakers to now keep their, answers brief, crisp, probably give some hacks and top 2 or top 3 pointers in that, so that we can cover as many more questions and help people who are reaching out to us with their queries. Avtar spoke about, the process and the startup community and everything. Now, interestingly, in today's scenario, Sunil, it has become change because of the pandemic times has become a strategic and an operational process. Now, we have somebody here, Anupam, who wants to know from you that are there some set methodologies for ushering in change management?
No, Anupam, there are no set methodologies for ushering in change management, because from the question that you asked, you're dealing with change. So you cannot have one singular response to different situations. And situations change every day, and you know, you have different changes that happen. For example, in the industry that I am in, you know, telecom, change is something which is a constant for us to even remain relevant. So it's not just about handling changes which are not expected, but also driving changes which we think are going to be making it more valuable for the customers to be with us. So for us, living with change on a daily basis is extremely important. So though there is no one set methodology for it, there are different situations to which you have different responses. For example, what Chitra said, what Avtar mentioned, Divya spoke about, the whole COVID situation, it was not something which was an expected situation. So changes for different people have been different. So you cannot really have any one methodology. You have to figure out what is it that is changing. You have to have your ears to the ground. You have to have the ability and the intent to quickly measure what is the actual event which is happening on the ground. So that helps in clarity of the mind. It helps in action planning. It helps in communication. Then you need to have the patience and the clarity of communication, as I said earlier. And then, as Avtar also said, you need to have the will to be able to drive that change. So there is no such one response to a changing situation. You need to be able to, if you're dealing with employees, if you're dealing with a situation at work, you need to be able to figure out how to involve and empower your teams on the ground for clear actions, how to regularly communicate, and as Avtar said, with empathy and equip them. Or in any change situation, I would say, how do you equip people with the latest technology, with the latest tools to be able to handle those changing situations? How do you automate yourself, in a manner that you can focus on what are those high impact activities which are driving change and how to handle them? How to involve different stakeholders, in the execution, starting from the planning to the end execution. So you have to be able to do that. And how do you keep, if you are dealing with a customer centric situation, how do you keep your customers at the center of it? So the last line on that question, no, there is no just one response to the changing situations. It has to be dealt with, with every situation, it has to be dealt with differently. And in every such situation, one aspect that you always need to remember is, don't forget the physical and mental well-being of the people with whom you're driving change. Because Avtar also mentioned, change follows a gravitational path. It follows from the top. So if you have a genuine care and you have a genuine self-adherence to discipline, then you are able to drive full potential when you are actually handling change. Because you must believe in your vision. You must believe in the change vision as well.
Right. Thank you, Sunil. Thank you so much. I'm going to quickly come to, Chitra. Chitra, well, Sunil is obviously talking about, how we can drive change and how we can get ahead of this. There is one gentleman who's trying to ask you a question, that how do we manage the sagging morals of teams in the current times? Because obviously, as Sunil said, it is a customized approach to every industry, to every organization, right? And how do we manage multiple teams? Because you've been a part of such large organizations.
Yeah, so yeah, generally the morale is very, very down, right? I mean, people are, and it's actually something which is very psychological, right? We're not meeting each other. We're not seeing each other. It's just those Zoom calls, and we've been kind of cut off from the team. See, what actually keeps the whole tempo going on in an organization is meeting people, having those team meetings, getting together, having those celebrations. All that has been taken away. 4.5 months, you're homebound, and you're not interacting. The physical interaction is not there, and that makes a big psychological impact on people. Yeah, and this I've noticed, and I've seen generally, even when they come for meetings, it's the morale is very low, and they don't know, and they're so uncertain about the future that you tend to kind of already it's a sagging morale, and not wanting to kind of, and nobody wants to punt, nobody wants to take any risk, nobody wants to disturb the existing apple cart or the equilibrium. Even if you think something needs to be done, they would like to keep mum and let this phase pass. of, right? So managing large teams, what I've always, while people always have this fear that because it's going to kind of hit the bottom line of an organization, there's going to be retrenchments, there would be people who would lose their jobs. And that's when I always tell, you know, people whom I meet or where I'm in these meetings or meet my ex-colleagues or in team meetings, is that the first thing one needs to do is there is, you know, leadership and learning are indispensable. There is no end to learning. One need to constantly upskill oneself. Just because you've got into a job, you're doing something, and you know you're just not skilling yourself enough, it's not necessary you need to get more degrees or whatever, but even within the job, within the process, if you're not able to upskill yourself, you tend to kind of be on the lower end of the spectrum. So that's something that each one of us do. I'm constantly learning, right? I don't think there is an end to learning. One needs to upskill and, you know, oneself all the time. That's one thing one needs to do. And you know, when you're managing large teams, it's very imperative that you kind of keep the team tempo on at all times. You know, there should be times when you should be able to counsel people. If you cannot do it at team meetings, at least have a one-on-one with people. And I think you should try and be as normal as you can. While we know we are not at work, we are all working through a remote mode, but I think you can keep the tempo on as much as you can. And then the reassurance to people, right? Both Sunil and Avtar emphasized on empathy so much. And I think that is the core of this whole existence, right? Empathy is something that we all leaders need to have in abundance. And you need to be empathetic. There will be some who may not be able to do as well in this current circumstance, right? Because of the remote working. And you actually cannot judge who's doing well and who's not, right? It's not the right environment right now to actually kind of put those 1-5 scale in terms of who's doing well and who's very good and who's excellent, etc. So that's something that we need to be empathetic. A is you need to be always approachable. You need to be able to, you know, listen to people, and you should be able to help out people. And I'm sure every organization in today's times, in this current times, are working along with HR to bring out a lot of those, you know, those team sessions or maybe even counseling sessions, which helps people to kind of come out of this kind of a low ebb in life.
Great. So is there any way of assessing risks, since you come from that industry, in the change management process?
So risks are plenty, right? Anything that you try to change, you're actually changing it to a new process. So obviously there's definitely going to be change. So we have a set template whenever we do any change, right? We go through a lot of testing, we go through a lot of approval process by a third party, be it a risk management team or a compliance team. We make sure that the third party guys are looking at it and, you know, giving their view on it. And it's constantly tested. Anything you try to do new, it goes through a whole lot of testing. It's not just that, you know, it's not a plug and play. It goes through a lot of iteration and testing. Yeah, that you need to be thorough in what you're doing before you actually implement the change.
Great. Thank you. Thank you, Chitra. And in fact, you have also answered the question from Rohit, who wanted to know thoughts on responsibility of the corporates to reskill, retrain their own employees to ensure least redundancy in job. I'm going to quickly have Amit come in here. Amit, if you can just quickly come in here. Because, you know, this has always been a conflict area with everybody, all organizations, that listen, is it the job of the organization or is it the job of the individual? Who is going to take responsibility for upskilling and retraining?
I think to answer this question, I would not rather go ahead and give the blame to either an organization or to an individual. I think that at their individual capacity, both, as in the organization, have to take certain responsibilities to upskill their employees, because at the end of the day, they are their team, right? So they are the core people in the organization who want to go ahead and generate revenue for them, right, in a longer period of time. So I think that investing on somebody who's your employee and that probably can go ahead being an asset to your organization. So I think that ideally organization should also invest. And during this period, I think that all of us have realized that we've been able to get a lot of time to reevaluate or self-assess. We've been self-assessing ourselves, right, during this time. And as a person, I think that we'd be able to identify certain areas wherein we need to upskill ourselves. So I think that I would say it's an equal responsibility of an individual to find out the areas and upskill in certain areas wherever he would see that there is an opportunity to improve. And I think that equally, it's equally important for an organization to also look into the assets of the organization, because they are the people, actually, right? So, and any organization, and you name it, right? It's not been built on bricks and walls, right? So it's been built because of the people in the organization, right? And when you invest into the right kind of individuals with right kind of skill sets, I think that in a longer period, they definitely want to go ahead and give you a lot of benefits.
Great. Thank you, Amit. Thank you so much. Allow me to just share from my experience to all the, you know, participants and attendees here that when I consult with organizations and we are driving change management as a process, you know, three things or three roadblocks always come to me. Number one is communication, as Avtar highlighted, is always mistaken as engagement. So they say, oh, you know what, change is happening. Let's just do some employee engagement or training and drive it ahead. So number one, communication is always mistook or sought for solutions in employee engagement. These are very two different aspects when it comes to change management process. Number two, we need to understand that we cannot open many battlegrounds, whereas some organizations in the order of, you know, being ahead of the curve, they want to open too many change management processes simultaneously. Prioritization for any leader is important, and that is something has been a roadblock for me and my team when we are advising. And number three, I've seen a certain sense of hierarchical dictatorship in the senior management, and I'm sure each one of you can relate to it, that if the CEO says this has to be changed, even if the managers or the mid-level segment does not agree with it, they go about, you know, implementing that without realizing that they are obviously not really boosting the morale and getting people demotivated. In fact, the employees of the organization start waiting for the CEO to, you know, leave the organization and probably a senior management person coming in. Interestingly, with all this discussion, the, you know, the first round of discussion, we are going to quickly jump into a little more strategic and operational and industry level expertise, because we have Shima Malhotra, who is requesting everybody, respected leaders, it is beneficial to go beyond empathy and deliver compassion. Okay, so Shima, thank you for driving our conversation in a little more technical sphere. And with this, I'm going to come to Avtar. Avtar, please advise us from an organizational standpoint, the top three strategic initiatives that we can take versus, you know, for startup community, what are the top two things that we can do to drive change?
So I'm not sure I got your question correctly. You're talking about the industry or you're talking about purely the startup industry as a subset?
I'm posing questions on that. You've also been, you know, more than a decade with Bank of America. Now that is one of the leading
26 years.
Wow. Okay. More than a decade.
I've had two stints. Okay. Yes.
So I think I'm going to request leaders here, if you can share what we call caselets or your experiences without, of course, naming the companies, but your experiences where you felt some challenges, how you overcome it, a mini short story that you can share, which gives us insights into the strategic initiatives that you did as a leader in driving change in your organization.
So let me actually first go back to the earlier kind of discussion on who's responsible for the career and make some two-line comment there. I've dealt with a large number of people running into very large thousands, very, very large actually. My belief is you're the only person responsible for your career. You cannot keep blaming the company, because I have seen in my experience, I'll give you one specific example. We used to have an annual appraisal form where there was a box saying, are you mobile? And if the answer to that question is yes, then the next question comes up, what region? Asia, Europe, US. So 80% of them would tick Europe, US, and 98% of them tick yes, I'm mobile. When we actually started talking to them saying, okay, there's an opening in Stanford, and I don't want to give you the company name, they should give you the company name by default. 2% only were coming forward. Rest had, my wife can't move, my mommy's unhappy. This is not the kind of profile, and I'll move for the right opportunity. And there's nothing called right opportunity. So this is one example. Second example is people tend to blame company for their own failure to take on challenging roles, because when the role is challenging, there's a risk attached to the role. So they are not open to taking risk. They only want to get a guarantee that you'll get promoted when I move there, but there is a risk of failure and then you'll be thrown out of the company. So more and more people who have switched roles within the same company and have taken on more challenging and diverse responsibilities, you will find from data, ultimately make it to the CEO jobs. Because for a CEO to be CEO, he needs to know, she needs to know finance, marketing, risk, HR. If you are a super expert, you should need to go and work for NASA, right? You can't be CEO of a company. So that's the fundamental problem. So let's come to your second question. So can you repeat so that I'm not very wasting time on the, repeat the question, please. You're on mute.
I'm gonna, yes. Great, thank you for deliberating on that point. And my prime question to you this time was that in your entire career that you spent at the Bank of America as a leader of the organization, I'm sure you've taken the company through different change management processes. What are those top two or top three strategic initiatives that you did?
So let me give you a simple, very simple example. When you're a company which is operating out of one location, you have as a CEO the ability to walk across and talk to everybody informally. That's what Chitra is saying, we are all missing. And you know, it works fine. I mean, there was a time when I shook hands with every employee in the building. It took me 9 hours, that's a different thing, to wish the Happy New Year. And fast forward 2 years, I could not have done that because I was in two different cities. And another 2 years, I was in three countries. So the point is, the model which works in one setting actually fails in the second setting. And one of the biggest challenge for a leader is to be seen as neutral, which I don't know how many of you run the global teams. There is always this question. So I was running a global vertical globally for Bank of America, and I was a guy who was Indian, living in India, and the large portion of my team was in India. So there was a very simple mindset. Ye desi hai, sara kaam desh mein le jayega. But that's not the job I was in. So my job was to make sure that I am doing strategically thinking for the company and saying whatever makes sense best wherever it goes, goes there. And it has a challenge also from both sides, because my own team used to question saying, why aren't you giving it to me? I mean, these are people who have grown up with me and were actually living in the same city and visiting my home on Sundays. Then I had other people who were from Latin America, Mexico and Filipinos and all that, who have never been to my house, but they were also my direct reports. So the idea was to do something which actually allows them to see in a very transparent manner that I'm being very professional, even when I'm distributing. So I'll tell you what I did, and I'm quoting specifics. I actually told my India business manager that I'm going to actually make you report to another lady in the US, an American who's my business manager. Now my calendar is controlled by an American lady who doesn't live in India, so you have no influence over her. The second thing I told everybody is, after 1 o'clock Eastern time, which is midnight India, if you need to talk to me, talk to her, because I'm sleeping. The third thing I did is I opened up my calendar to all my direct reports across the globe. So they don't need to actually worry that I'm spending overly extra time with the India team and I'm ignoring the Mexico and the Philippines. I mean, there are a couple of guys I believe on the call today. So this also then meant, and then I told my admin in India that all India meetings must get over at 3 o'clock. From 3 o'clock onwards, East Coast opens. So all meetings after 3 are video with the global team. So there are a lot of small things which actually are nothing but change management initiatives, which create a comfort in the mind of larger audience saying, I am being fair to everybody across the world. And I'm not, just because I'm an Indian living in India, I am not going to favor Indians. So there are a lot of these smaller, softer issues. Your earlier example of the mandate from top, I used to also tell that my philosophical bent was this, that if two people come to me for a solution, there are two very simple things which happen. First thing is that they both completely are agreeing that they have failed to resolve an issue, because that's why you need me, right? So if you come to me, be my guest, but then this is the first conclusion I reached, that you two of you as leaders failed. The second problem I used to tell them is that I could not be making the right choice. There's a possibility that I may not know the subject well enough, but I'm going to make a choice because you want me to make a choice. And if I make a wrong choice, no option to come back. So this was another way to address your earlier question, saying this mandate business. See, you have to create a structure where there is an inclusive leadership. Collectively, the top management has to be taking responsibility for running the company. You might be a risk head, but you're still management team member. So there is a second hat for you. So everybody at a certain level and above has to behave like a CEO and know what is happening in the company. a simple example, if my HR guy will tell me that I'll come back to you to tell you what is my HR head count, then the guy should be fired. That's your bread and butter. But that also doesn't mean that you don't know anything about the balance sheet of the company. See, everybody knows their job. Chitra will tell you that all risk guys, and I'm not making any derogatory remarks, and I'm just giving an example. So that's the other principle for change management, that you need to make everybody responsible and get involved, because they all want to be called leaders, but they don't want to look beyond their own small cubicle and their own team, and they don't even interact with the other functions. So fundamentally, the organization's depth, capability, and success is a function of how many people in your company actually can present another function on their behalf without them being in the room. That's a fundamental check. If you have more and more of those people, you have top talent in your company. So that's my change. You know, so I have driven this. I'll give a second example of my change management. So I used to actually have an idea that everybody should be cost conscious. So every time I would expand to a city, another city, I will not tell the head of real estate to build that complex. No, I will actually handpick somebody who has never built a building, saying, this is your project. End to end is your responsibility. This is the budget. This is the outcome. Please go deliver. At the end of that project, in 6 or 7 months, the guy would know the detail of the cost structure like nobody's business. So everybody in my management team in those days used to be a super CFO. So they'll never waste money. We were the most efficient team in the company globally for several years. I don't know what happens today. So these are all change management practices, because, you know, normally a guy who's real estate head will do a real estate. That's normal. How about an HR guy doing real estate?
Yes. Excellent. No, that is very, very well said. And I think to summarize, two very important things which stand out from your conversation, Avtar, with us is that, number one, of course, delegation and communication and authenticity of a leader is important, but the culture of the organization and the cohesiveness of the senior management team. We have to be unified as a whole to drive any change management process. I'm going to quickly come here to Sunil, because I'm getting bombarded with all the questions here. So
you're muted, Divya, you're muted. I can't hear your question. Sorry.
Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Great. So this is a little bit of a tough one that somebody has asked you, and it is related obviously to the present, controversial times with China. So Mr. Sanjeev Hans wants to know that 70% of smartphones sold are Chinese. Who can fill this big gap if the bans on Chinese goods continues? Should we continue to do business with any of these Chinese companies if we get a chance? Of course, it is also related to our change management process as a country, because the governance is actually going through that process right now in a very confused manner. So your thoughts?
Yeah, well, I think honestly, I always expect this question whenever I'm in these kind of conferences, and because of the current situation. So, well, yes, it's true, 70% of smartphone contribution today in the country is by the Chinese companies. And yes, the country is also in the process of undergoing a change, and the Prime Minister himself has given the call for what he said, Atmanirbhar Bharat. Let me also say, in the same context, when he says Atmanirbhar, he does not mean that you do everything yourself. Atmanirbhar also means interdependent. So it's easy to wish or try to wish away their presence in the country, in terms of posturing. However, in order to be able to do that, we need to be able to first be in a position to be able to fulfill that gap of 70%. So there is a demand that needs to be fulfilled for 70% of the people. We need to fulfill that. We need to be able to prepare towards it. We need to be able to build systems for it. One of the methodologies which was adopted for that, because for several years, component manufacturing has not taken off in this country, in spite of several initiatives announced by the government, but people have not been forthcoming in terms of setting up you know, the semiconductor manufacturing and the other component level manufacturing. However, the government did take initiatives of ensuring that all brands which were wanting to sell their products in India were doing certain basic manufacturing in the country. So if you look at it today, all these Chinese brands have actually set up their factories in India. Whether it is in Tamil Nadu, or whether it's in Andhra or Telangana, or whether it is in Uttar Pradesh or Gujarat or some of the other states. So all these people have actually set up their manufacturing units here. And there are others who are also wanting to do that. It's not just about the Chinese companies, but the others are also doing it. Even the Korean companies and the American companies are now starting to manufacture in India. The key thing is to be able to create that environment and to be able to give those benefits which enable these brands to come and they start to manufacture here. Another aspect, you know, which I want to also highlight over here is it right to start to differentiate or call one company as Chinese, the other company as American, the other company as Korean, the other company as something else? You know, it takes me back to my first organization, you know, Philips. Now, Philips is a Dutch organization. But because Philips had been operating in India for, you know, when I joined, it was about 85 years or 90 years. It was considered as Indian. You know, today we call Hindustan Unilever, but Unilever was never an Indian company it was always a European company. However, today, if you look at it, you turn around and say, you know, Hindustan Unilever, they say it's an Indian company. For that matter, several other organizations or brands are like that, wherein, you know, you've lived with those brands for several years and decades, so you think that they are Indian. And I'm not saying that for even a minute that, you know, two countries should be posturing with each other in a political manner, in such a manner that, you know, it leads to business disruptions between the countries. Because today the world is about interdependence. It is not just about, you know, and the cry or the message from the Prime Minister also is about, interdependence when he says Atmanirbhar. Atmanirbharta is about how do I make the best use of the resources which are global in trying to bring them into the country.
Sunil, very well answered. And, you yourself have been a part of an organization, of course, barring aside the current unprecedented times and the China controversial, entire environment, whether it was Nokia, Samsung, you have driven a lot of change within your organizations. I mean, Nokia used to be a leading brand and today, of course, Samsung is a leading brand. Now, tell me that... has there been an experience where you thought a certain process should be implemented to drive change, but your manager or your team leader disagreed with you? And how did you overcome that? Because a lot of people want to know that. That as a leader, are you always right?
Well, no, I don't think as a leader, you get it 100% right, you know, all the time. But sometimes as a leader, you know, you have visibility to certain changes that are happening, which sometimes, you know, your team members might not have. So it's important to be able to onboard each and every one of those team members to be able to establish a clear communication in terms of what is the change going to impact or what is it that, you know, we are attempting to do. Once you're able to do that, then, you know, it becomes easier. And I recall, I mean, I would not name the organization, but, you know, during my Nokia days, we had to make a significant change to the way we went to the market, to our go-to-market strategy. And we had a national distribution partner, which was another large organization, a publicly held company. So anything that we did, you know, in terms of driving that change was always going to impact, their bottom line. It was going to impact their share price. It was going to impact the organization's position. Yet we had to drive that change. So the only way we were able to do that was by bringing them on board, by showing them what the vision was all about, by, you know, for the change, and then enabling them to understand and actually internalize and then drive it together. As a result of that, you know, the entire change took place in the time which was specified that it takes place, and neither of the organizations suffered. In fact, the business grew for both the organizations. So yes, I mean, there are changes which sometimes the employees don't understand, or sometimes their colleagues don't understand, and sometimes there are resistance to changes. And I dare say if I have a couple of minutes, I would actually like to talk about that as well, because any change brings about a certain amount of resistance. So in my view, experience of success, comfort with success, insecurity which rises with your experience, closing of your minds to new learnings and to new techniques and to new technology, it leads toward mediocrity. When it leads toward mediocrity, it leads towards a resistance to change. And added to that, the inability of certain leaders to be able to actually nurture young talent who might definitely be smarter than you are in terms of the knowledge, in terms of processes, and even in terms of driving innovation. That's the other part which makes it difficult. And then my message would be, even if you're not driving the change, but if you are able to accept change and work along to make it successful, you still have a chance to see progress, and you still have a chance to progress yourself. Else you can be sure that either you'll get added to the list of the parasites, or you'll get added to the list of the dinosaurs. So one has to be ready to accept these change, to drive and contribute towards change, because with the kind of role which technology is playing in our lives, on a daily basis and in our work, change is the only thing which you will see on a daily basis. Whether it's the current situation which you see of COVID, or whether it is, as Avtar mentioned, who would have thought you would have a call like this with 100 or more people? Who would have thought I'm not going to go to a restaurant for X amount of time? Who would have thought that I'm going to work from home and also actually ensure that there is a home environment which has undergone a change? So now families, are accepting the fact that you're working from home, and they're giving you that respect of that time, and adjusting to the different schedules. And if there are two or more people working in home, they are actually respecting each other and adapting to that change. So I think, Chitra and Avtar both had mentioned earlier, the quicker you are able to adapt to the changes, the quicker or more comfortable your life becomes, in terms of learning. And you yourself have to be responsible for it. And there are, of course, it's leaders' responsibility to drive it, to be able to have that patience and be able to hear and address the concerns. Do definitely address the concerns, what the leaders need to do. But, it's also up to the individual to be able to actually adapt to changes and adapt very quickly.
That's right. Well spoken, Sunil. So much to learn from that conversation. I'm going to quickly jump to Chitra here. Chitra, there is a question for you from Mr. Talib Khan. And he says that work from home was a forced change and many companies successfully adopted it. What is your take on work from home posture? Should MNCs focus on this part of core strategic and strategies and continue this for a long time?
So yeah, Talib, hi. Talib used to be part of my team, so fine. So we did have this policy. I mean, I think in the last 4 or 5 years, once a month or whenever you had any emergency, we were allowing our staff to work from home. However, it depended upon the the kind of controls they were managing within the process. But I think this is a new normal. It's going to stay from what I see. And it also helps, right? It helps the organization also in managing those core functions which need not be physically present in the office in terms of managing the process can still be managed from a remote place. It's also a great resiliency initiative, right? God forbid if there is any, you know, we used to actually do a quarterly disaster control resiliency exercise every 3 months between our various centers, just to make sure that if any day if there's an emergency and the center goes down, the other center is able to pick up and run the show without a problem. But I think this particular pandemic has actually made it very effective, and all the other issues that we had, the small loopholes in terms of managing DC exercise, has been plugged now. So irrespective of what, we are all in a resilient mode. All centers are in a BC mode right now. So I think it's going to stay. It's a new normal. It is also a plus, right? Those people who are living in cities like Mumbai, Bangalore, it takes us two and a half hours one way to get back home. And what I've noticed in this last 4.5 months is that the productivity has actually increased. People are able to log in for a longer time and stay online. Rather than running for the buses or the vehicles, the roster vehicles which would drop them home. That also gives you that, you know, the flexibility in terms of managing your work hours, and also the pressure, the stress of going through a traffic in Mumbai or in Bangalore, right? It keeps you calm, you're composed, you're able to take care of your work. And I feel the productivity has actually increased. This is what some of my colleagues told me, that people are more relaxed, able to give in more, able to extend and stretch when the need arises without, you know, actually have to worry about getting back home. I think the organization will also benefit. We don't need those big, large centers now. We don't keep on extending. See, this is what happens, right? Whenever processes come into India or we bring in a new business, we throw bodies. We just hire people, and then, you know, the while the system piece is there, the first thing we do is we hire people and we throw bodies into the process. This will have a change now. We really don't need, we will kind of focus more on process, focus more on tech, and try and make it more, more automatic, rather than, you know, pushing in bodies in there to do the work. So I think these are, and while none of us touched about the various transformations that are happening in the industry, from a robotics or from an OCR and other places, right? See, being from the banking industry, every process need to be authorized. There has to be a 6-4-eye checkup. So if somebody is entering a transaction, there is another pair of eyes just to authorize it. It's a regulation across the world. There's a 4-eye process. Certain transaction beyond a threshold, we need to have 6 eyes. So there's a third person, a third VP who will kind of, a third person will be a senior person like a VP will kind of authorize the transaction. I think with these robotics and these new tech that is coming in, the AI piece, those duplication and multiple keystrokes are all eliminated, and all of that kind of get processed through the rapid process automation. And these are some of these benefits that are coming into the industry with these AI and RPA and OCR, etc., right? And all this is going to actually give benefit. Rather than just do those mundane jobs of putting in transaction, people can excel. They can actually do more strategic work. They can do more specialized processing and manage the clients better. That nobody touched on, I just thought we should talk about it as well. That's a big change to the industry. It's not only banking, it's happening everywhere, right? So yeah,
absolutely.
No, it's gonna stay.
True. This is the new normal. Future of work is here. And the good part is, I think because of this digital transformation, we don't live in an era anymore where, you know, the change processes are going to be defined by the industry. I think the change processes, more so in my opinion, are going to be defined by the leaders in respective organizations. Leadership is blending in, organizational expertise is blending in, and certain way how we lead change, how we process change, has become pretty subjective to the person who is going to be driving that change initiative. Now, we've been talking a lot about change. Well, before I go on to Avtar, here's an affirmation, a reaffirmation from Mr. Rahul Jindal to everybody here on the panel. Work from home is a reality and has pushed people to set up calls for anything and everything. During these times, obviously, COVID is a part of life and is going to remain. As leaders driving change, companies should alter their processes, give more freedom to employees to make people life easier and healthy. You know, technology industry always gave more freedom, but now I think manufacturing industry and banking industry is also trying to take the leap of getting a little more automated and getting a little more flexible in their work hours and helping employees do better. Thank you, Mr. Jindal, for that feedback and input. Okay, so I'm going to move on to Avtar. Avtar, we have Vishal who had emailed us a question that change management in itself has management word associated with the process of change. So is it just a management subject? Number one. Number two, as an investor in current times, what are you looking for in startups? Because I know from the startup community that they are struggling for funding, they are struggling for support, and how during the current times, they are also some of them shutting down their businesses. So twofold question to you. Hope you can advise us on both the aspects.
So change management. I think the word management gets used in multiple ways. When you talk about change management, you're actually referring to a process which is well-defined and is being adhered to in a strictest possible way if the change is very defined. If the change itself is not defined, the process cannot be defined. So this is what I was talking about. If you're talking about a internal company, I mean, what Chitra was talking about, if you want to change a process, like in technology, you have a SDLC, if there are some techies on this call, which is a change management process for a new code to go into production. There are stagings, you test it first, the unit testing, all those, you know, different. So that's a process thing. And the intent there is to minimize the risk of failure and the system is failing. But when you take a larger, you know, view, the management definition and widens quite a bit. It is a dynamic, you know, this thing, because if the change is unknown, the management also will be unknown. So it has to be the ability of the people involved. It's not just the manager to be able to collectively react to any unexpected results of any kind and correctively, you know, move in a particular direction, which is less risky comparatively, because till you get to the answer, you don't know what is the right answer. So it's very interesting. So to me, the word change management actually is a little bit ill-defined, because we still take a very narrow view and we always refer to change management as an internal process. You know, when you're moving work from US to India, how will it ensure that this customer is not suffering and the work is still happening, although people are shifting from, you know, location A to location B, or new people are being hired and they're being trained. So those are all defined processes of change management, but the change is very limited. It's a location change. The customer is not seeing the product change, everything. So that's a very narrow view. The change in a bigger sense is more management, and that's where the challenges of uncertainty comes much harder. That's what the new world is going through, by the way. The beauty is, and also sometimes we use the term startup. The reality is these are all aggregators and the app providers. There are the unfortunate part of India is that we do very, very limited real innovation. We do packaging. Right. You know, if something has been seen in US, we want to replicate under a different name, all that. So that's there. Coming back to what the challenge and what I see happening in this, scenario, there are a couple of things which are very visible. I think one is the level of uncertainty has suddenly gone up. What does it mean? It actually could mean that the number of customers you can reach could be very different from what you thought earlier. How the customer will buy could be very different, because the customer's own income is getting impacted. So you don't know whether the people will come. Then there are a lot of industries which are having very significant number of startups where the regulation doesn't allow. I mean, all the F&B industry today is shut down because there is no, I mean, there are enough startups which were, you know, Swiggy's and, you know, all those guys were doing, say, 500,000 deliveries, and now they're doing 20,000. So that's another version of the change. So the point I'm making is the models are shifting. The regulator is putting a lot of restrictions. You know, you have the red zones where you can't even step out. So forget buying, you can't eat, right? So those things are there. And then the other thing is, because of this environmental change, there are a lot of pivots were taking place. You know, if this is not working, let's do something else. So there are those things. But in this whole thing, if you were to ask me, the biggest risk which these guys run is, one is the client side, where is somebody there to pay for my product? That's the first big question, and how many of them? And the second question, which is even more complicated in today's environment, given the complication around China and all that which Sunil was talking about in a very different area, is the investment part, right? So if, you know, many of the startups actually have a burn model where you just keep pumping volume and keep paying for it because hoping one day you'll have enough data and you'll monetize, and you can debate all that, you know, thing as long as you want. But the point is that. So suddenly now that has become a question mark. Will my next round go through? Right? So there is a lot of jitteriness around how the future looks like. Of course, there are exceptions, you know, in the healthcare space and in the telecom space and all, there are exceptions. They're actually seeing more positive. You know, there are new industries. It's called mask. There was no industry called mask. Now it's a huge industry, right? The thing. So those things are happening. So what is driving all this is only one simple thing, that you need to understand you don't know when the next money will come. And you don't know when your original estimated time of turning around or becoming positive in terms of, you know, break even is going to realize. If it is 2 years, now it might be 7 years. Now, it also has other implications because typically the startup world has many components of it. There are investors, there are founders, there are co-founders, there are angels, and there are customers. Customers stop buying, it doesn't matter to them. I don't buy, I don't pay, I'm period. Now, investor is stuck because he's taken somebody's money to put into somebody else's company. And they have a defined period of, you know, time. Founders also have the same challenge that I am putting my 5 years, when will I see? So there are a lot of implications. So the moral of the story is very simple. But in this environment, I keep telling everybody that cash is the king. Do not tell me how much you will have. Tell me how much you have. And everything else is just an Excel sheet. And the beauty of what Excel is, you can add a zero, it looks beautiful. Right? So the only rule I tell all my people is that please tell me how much real cash you can conserve. And to conserve that cash, you have to follow two basic principles. One is you need to make sure that your team is with you. Because if you lose your team, by the way, in startups, the biggest thing is product and the team. There's no third thing. You can throw any amount of money and get any amount of footfall. You send a free lunch to every home in Delhi, they'll all eat. Start charging, they'll say, go home. That's how it works. And a lot of companies do that. So that's the first rule. The second thing I told them is you have to make sure that when you are not sure, take out all the cost, which means return your space. And I have a different view on the work from home not coming back. We can debate that on another day. It will be back to office, because not going to office is like eating chaat without masala. We can debate that separately. Yeah. So the thing I was telling you is that that's the second thing, that conserve cash means take out all expenses.
Right.
But important thing is, if you don't have your team aligned to what you're doing, you will actually lose some top talent. And as a possibility of that is very high, because the talent brings the product knowledge. It's the right. IP is what is getting valued. So that's the other thing. And true. The other thing is, you also need to get involved in the other stakeholders. You have to actually have a very deeper conversation with your investors and make them understand what you're doing, so that they're not thinking that you're not doing all the right things. So that's the other thing we tell them. That the communication has suddenly become more relevant and important. And the last thing I tell them is keep the faith, because if you dishearten, you know, how will you motivate your team? So that's the last thing.
Avtar, because you mentioned that second last point, I was about to ask you a question which has come in from Sunil Verma, specifically to you. How to make leaders understand the importance of change at the bottom of the pyramid rather than only among the top leaders in closed rooms at any organization? Clearly, I can hear the desperation in his voice.
I don't think it's a change question. It's a communication question. The fact is, he's saying, I don't know what's happening inside the boardroom. That's the question. It's not a change question. So when I used to run the company, and if there are people from that team on the thing, they can vouch for it. We used to have the highest satisfaction score across the globe every year.
Wow.
And the reason for that is very simple. We used to engage everybody. And I'll tell you, there are simple formats. If you put five people of different hierarchies in the same meeting, I'll tell you, nothing will come out. Nobody will be honest. Nobody will be open. He will look at his boss. Should I ask that question? you know, in without giving you the name, in a boardroom at Madam Kama Road, and that Sunil will understand what I'm talking about, there are 15 GMs and two MDs and one chairman sitting. And you ask a question, they look at each other and they are looking for a nod from somebody saying, yeah, you can answer. That's not the culture you want. We want a culture where everybody is equal, because as I also used to tell them that we are all part of the same team and we are paid differently because we bring different skills. That's the only difference. As far as the treatment is concerned, we are all going to be treated the same way. Sometimes in companies, specifically in India, and I say this with confidence because I worked with one desi company not so long ago, the designation decides the power. That should not be the case. So if you have an inclusive meritocracy, as we used to call it in our company, you will find people are open to even reaching out to the CEO. I've had people, let me give you my own example. I've had a person, or actually three ladies, walk into my office in Hyderabad in 2006 or something, or five. And actually tell me, I want to talk to you. I was thinking there's some serious complaint coming up. So we can't have the courage to come alone. So we thought of ganging up and asking you this. You know what they wanted? They wanted me to not look like Amit Kapoor. That's the openness in culture. They said, you're looking ugly. Why don't you shave your beard? And we don't have the guts. So that's the level of comfort people need to have. Because in an equality, what Chitra said, doesn't start at the senior management. I'm telling you again, in my philosophy, the salary differentiation and the band differentiation is a function of vintage and experience. It should not have any implication for the treatment part of the job.
Right.
Because all of you live the same core values, right? There is no higher integrity and lower integrity. There's only one integrity. So how can it be the same for everybody?
Fantastic. Let me just loop in Sunil here. Sunil, I have a twofold question for you. And this is inspired from so many questions and comments and feedbacks pouring in and Avtar's answer. You've been an entrepreneur yourself for some time, as I recall. So number one, do you agree with Avtar when he's talking about in the current situation where cash is king, and that is going to probably be the biggest trend of driving through change process for small businesses?
His company is the biggest cash holder right now. What is the discussion?
That is the next question. If you can share with us, because I think all our participants will extremely learn a lot from the current scenario. If any change, how did you drive it with your managers and change drivers within the organization that is Reliance Jio Infocom?
Well, you know, to answer the first question, I do agree with Avtar. But I also like to add that, you know, one of the other factors which is extremely important for the startups is what is the idea that you're working on? What is that innovation that you're trying to drive? And what is the change that you're trying to, or what is it that you're trying to achieve? Do you have clarity of that? And because that, and then do you also have the strength and guts to be able to stand up for what you're trying to drive? Not related to a startup, but you know, I would like to recall a couple of incidents which, you know, when I was trying to drive a change in one of my earlier organizations, and it was related to how the channel would work. So there were people from one of the states who came back and said, in fact, two states where I got objection, and I said, we will boycott the products of this brand now because we don't accept this change that has been driven by, you know, the whims and fancies of Sunil Dutt. So that was the feedback which I got. And I said, no worries. Maybe it's about, you know, whether, and you know, and that question was there about, you know, communicating at the bottom of the pyramid. So it's not about bottom of the pyramid, but going to the last level of the channel, you know. So I thought maybe there was a issue there, and in fact that was proven right. So to one state I actually flew down, and because the president and the secretary and everybody else of the association of those trade partners were waiting for me to discuss that. The first thing that they tell me is, you know, we want to compliment you on the kind of changes that you're bringing about. So I had to turn around to my team and look and say, if that's the first statement, then where's the problem? And I asked them, I said, so where's the problem in that case? You know, if that is what you feel, that this is great for the industry, then what is it that the problem is? So the problem is you haven't given us a chance to participate in it. we've been around in this industry for so long. So I had to actually, and I realized that it was a communication problem, as Avtar mentioned, you know, it was, I had to actually go and explain to them the process that we had gone through for selection of certain partners and processes, et cetera, et cetera, and why they did not qualify for it, some of them. And within 2 days, I was attending another sort of a webinar, but it wasn't like that during those days because, you know, we didn't have this kind of connectivity. But I was addressing them over a conference call, about 400 people, and thanking them for the support which they were giving me. Something very similar happened with another state with whom I actually entered into another call, and we had a video call with them, and you know, I started to speak, and they had a list of some 15 demands. I agreed to about half of them, but I had to have the clarity to tell them the other half cannot be done, and why they cannot be done, and why they cannot be accepted. Fact is, if you're able to communicate with clarity and with conviction and be genuine about what you're saying, it gets accepted, and it did get accepted. So, I mean, I do recall these two examples, you know, when I saw that question about, you know, driving that change at the bottom of the pyramid. Coming to, you know, Reliance, I think as a organization and as a culture, what we try to build or we try to do, because we live with change every day. We've driven it, you know, from the fact that, you know, we made data so much available and be comfortable to be used because of the kind of, you know, the technology that we brought in, the content that we brought in, the ease of, you know, getting to connect with the world that we brought in. So these require some huge changes. And like, we could have actually bought out several of those 2G, 3G operators who were anyway going belly up. But then what was the change that we could have brought for the country? Nothing.
Right.
So it was about bringing those new technologies, which was always the focus area for, you know, starting from our chairman to each and every person in the organization.
Right.
All along the last 5 to 6 years, we've lived with change every day. Whether it is about, you know, convincing some of my earlier friends in the device industry for bringing in 4G devices, which supported voice over LTE, et cetera, and them resisting that change, to then demonstrating why it is important to be able to do that. So sometimes you need to demonstrate also. So we actually went and bought, you know, devices which were 4G and which supported voice over LTE, and we changed the entire industry. So from zero 4G, to 100% 4G smartphone within 12 months, the entire industry shifted. Then, you know, when we're trying to drive changes, again, on a daily basis, I see, you know, and especially in my own function, I see, as I mentioned, the comfort of experience actually brings resistance. And
well said.
We have actually driven so many changes in the way we reach to our customers. Even during this whole COVID period, when it started, I saw several people across several industries, across several organizations who said, boss, everything is shut down. Abhi to ghar baithna hai, sab kuch to shut down ho gaya. But for us, important part was to ensure that every person remained connected, you know, to each other and to the world. That was one big, huge task in front of us. So we actually, while the entire retail market was shut, we actually innovated, we actually thought through, we actually brought about those changes by which not only were some of our channel partners able to get connected to the customers and recharge their phones constantly, but also we trained our own manpower. And again, you know, to what Avtar said, it is about cross-functional expertise that you need to develop. So we actually brought in the expertise within our own people to be able to reach out to customers to ensure that they were remaining connected to each other and remaining connected to the network so that they could connect with each other. Some of the best works for that, reaching out to the customer and customer handling, was possibly maybe not done by the sales guys. It was done by the service people. It was done by the other people, you know, who took it up as a challenge, who took it up as a task, and actually delivered it with a lot of ingenuity and a lot of, I would say, genuineness, you know, with which they approached the customers. So as a result of that, we not only maintained, but we grew our business during this COVID period. And right. Of course, you know, in terms of the other changes, what everybody is visible to is about the platforms business, which has attracted so much of not just investments, but also strategic partnerships from different organizations across the global organizations. That comes when you're able, when you have confidence that here is an organization which is not only being able to manage change, but also is actually driving change for the country and for its people. So when you're driving change for your people, you're driving change for your country. I think that is something which is extremely important. That's something that we live with on a daily basis.
Thank you so much. That really is a lot of learning for us from your experiences, Sunil. Talking about technology, we are coming towards the end of the session. I've already sort of overshot the time. I hope I have a thumbs up from all the speakers that it's okay to take another 5-10 minutes. Is that okay? A thumbs up from everybody?
Right. Five, seven.
Great. Okay. I'm trying constantly to absorb many questions into one when I'm asking you so that more people feel involved and encouraged in this masterclass. Chitra, there is a question to you from Uday Nagpure. He says that during this work from home, how the banking and finance company is dealing with data security, because data is crucial in banking and finance. One second, Chitra, we'll have to unmute you. Yes, go.
Yeah, so, these controls are not something that we're even within the organization when we are working. The firewalls and the systems are all capable of managing the data integrity. And wherever you're working, when even from a remote location, it's like 100 remotes compared to 5 branches. I mean, the technology is also the same, the process is the same. So data integrity is something that, of course, there's more emphasis on data integrity and security right now because there's too many people logged in from different locations. So the firewalls, so people who have to log in have to go through a particular protocol of the organization. You can't log in from any device and anywhere. These are devices given by the bank. The laptops are all given by the bank. The rest of the other functionalities of the laptop are all disabled. It's only the system of the bank that is allowed with those with those firewalls and protection software. So I mean, it's well taken care of.
You're on mute, Divya.
Yes. I'm sure Uday is going to be very happy to know that his money is safe in all the banks.
Yeah.
With so much of, even the Zoom was getting hacked sometime back and so many cyber frauds and cyber crimes increase that is happening around the world. It is definitely a valid question. Wow. So I'm going to summarize the questions and come for a last final round. Avtar, I'm going to come to you first. We have one final take from you because many questions are associated with that in organizations. How do we keep everybody motivated in terms of adapting the process of change and implementing it, especially in current times? So how do we do that? Give us some insight into like something that they can go back and implement in their organization, all our attendees.
See, there are multiple simple, things which need to be the focus area. One is the connect between what we are trying to do as a change and how does it actually connect to the big picture. Most companies actually control the big picture in the top 10, 15 heads. Once you communicate that big picture in a transparent manner, it's a very simple game. You take the top 20 people in a room and give them a slip, tell them to write top 3 priorities of this company and see what they write. First of all 10 of them will write 3 different things. You take it a level below, you keep going, and you'll see that complete shift, Chinese whisper, takes place. So first thing is you need to find a way to explain why this change is very much connected to the big picture, which the overall company wants to achieve. And the second thing is, you also need to be able to articulate as to how this change is going to be beneficial for all employees of the company and their future. Sometimes people actually see this as a waste of time because they think nothing is going to come out of it. It's just going to be unnecessary work. It's useless things to do. But moment they start to relate to it, it kind of becomes, wow, we must do it. Because then it's not a push. It is a pull which starts to take place. Most companies only fail on this. You know, the processes are there, technology is there, gyan dene wale bahut aaye, consultant bahut aate hain. But the problem is the internal communication is very restricted to very transactional agenda. And changes in some places are transactional, but in most places, the big real change is actually strategic. And there is very least amount of communication which takes place around the strategy of the company beyond certain levels. It happens in the boardroom all the time. So you need to have a message which is going to everybody. You know, the town halls are a great format. You know, the written communication never get read. So I have a view on email, you know, that also we can discuss in great detail. Right? No, I challenge anybody on this panel if they read all their mails in detail. And anybody says, so let's have a conversation. I'll actually prove you wrong. I did that many years ago.
I'm just a consultant, as you said.
I'm saying nobody reads the mails.
Okay.
So the point I'm making is the whole connect between where the company is going and how does it relate to me going somewhere is the missing link. Solve for that. Everything else is in place. You'll have the highest motivation level in the team and the lowest attrition in the team. There'll be people who will be fighting to be part of the project teams. Today, sometimes you have to force people to be part of project teams. So there's no buy-in. Oh, you've been nominated. You don't even know what you're going to do.
Right.
So that's my take.
Right. No, thank you so much. Coming to you, Chitra, your final take on how we can make a difference, especially coming from a very fast-moving and a critical industry such as yourself. Today, in fact, our economy is being driven sluggishly, so to say, because everybody's trying to cope up with automation. But what is it that you would like to share as your final two takeaways from this discussion?
The first thing would be to keep the faith. Yeah. As Avtar said, this will also pass. It will pass for sure. The second thing is, I think there is, you know, you need to, the innovation and the innovation and wanting to excel actually comes out when you're in an adverse position, right? Adversity actually brings about innovation. And I think it's all about innovating and making sure that how we are able to manage or adapt ourselves to this new environment where things are going to be remote, where processes are going to be, you know, managed outside the office. And also the economy being sluggish, how is it that, what is it that we need to do? Come up with some innovation to try and market better, try and, you know, keep the client communication on so that you're able to bring in the customer delight. It's not the client is doing well either, right? It's impacted all the industries across. It's just to keep the momentum on, keep the faith, and manage to do your work well. Better each day, better than the other.
Yeah. Great. Thank you so much. Very, very well said. Sunil, we are talking about customers and we are talking about teams. Who in your sense takes a priority in current times to drive the change management process?
Well, I would say, you know, customers are central to anything and everything that you want to drive, especially if you are in a customer-centric industry and you are addressing the needs of the customer, then that is central to whatever you do. But in terms of who's responsible for driving the change, it's the teams. It's your people. And when I say teams, it's end to end. You know, starting from the leadership team, going right up to the last person who's interacting with the customers. So each and every person needs to be able to understand what the importance of any kind of a strategy for the organization is, whether it is a continuation, whether it is a change, or whether it is something absolutely new. So those are extremely important, to be able to communicate well, to be able to articulate it properly, to be able to make it fact-based. So that's extremely important. In doing that, what I would say is people now onwards, especially more than earlier times, need to start becoming comfortable with technology. You don't have to be an engineer, but you need to be able to at least know how to use technology and how to put it to the right use, because technology is one factor which is driving change in our lives on a daily basis. this is going to only increase. It's not going to come down. You know, and therefore, it's extremely important that you start becoming comfortable with it. So whether you are a young person in the organization or whether you are, you've been around, you know, for several decades, like some of us here in this call, you need to be very, very sure that, you know, you adapt to that change and start learning about technology sooner than later.
Right. No, very well said. We all need to adapt. We all need to innovate. We all need to communicate. Quickly, Amit, I'm going to come to you just to summarize this entire thing and share your closing remarks.
So I think that first of all, hearing Sunil, Avtar, Chitra has been a delight. And then I think that the takeaway from this session is immense. And I think that I would not be able to kind of conclude it in a couple of words. The way that Sunil really talked about upskilling an individual in terms of and understand that how important technology is, and we all know as in terms of it is something which is a very common take from everyone here in terms of Chitra, Avtar and Sunil, that we all need to upskill, and this is the time that we have right now. And I think that we've been deliberately given this time, and I think that we need to capitalize this time at our best, because change is something which is constant, and this time period has really made us realize the same. So simple, when we say that if we cannot go out chopping down the trees today, right, then utilize this time to sharpen the axe, because once you'll be moving out, I'm sure that you will have sharp tools available with you. So that is something which I feel is a takeaway from this particular session. And definitely leaders being always, as in this has been well known, then great leaders born during crisis period as well. So it's during crisis that you actually see leaders coming in. The major takeaway, another major takeaway here is the kind of emotional attachment that you should have with your team, because when you're driving any kind of a change, right, it is very difficult for any individual to accept those change, right? Because there are a lot of background to it, right? So people might have a lot of assumptions that they might take away, because this is a very uncertain time. There might be shift in terms of their roles. There might be their jobs get redundant because of any new technology coming in and into picture. So I think that we need to really go ahead and be with the team, people who are going through that change, that this will not definite, this is, the intent is not to take away anything from you. It is probably building in another set of capabilities in you, right? Which might be unique and different from what you have been doing so far. So I think that this is what I would like to conclude to all the leaders, that emotionally they need to have their team together. They need to understand the people who are going through change are typically who will get impacted. So leaders who are introducing them, so they need to understand, as again we evolve, Avtar also mentioned about it, from top to bottom. I think that information has to be passed in a very clear way, that why this change is required and how it will benefit them.
And I can actually understand where your thoughts are coming from, Amit, because leading a recruitment firm, you're actually dealing with a lot of information on ground zero, right? Because you are getting the feedback from other end of the spectrum, and probably that is a great request and you know, a submission to all the industry leaders that we have on the panel here.
Yes, I think that irrespective to any industry, recruitment has really gone a major transformation right now.
True.
Right.
Sure.
When onboarding is happening virtually, you can't take interview face to face, wherein businesses were so reluctant initially that they wanted to really see an individual and take an interview. Right. So sure. I think there's a lot of changes that I've seen. Candidates are getting reluctant. They do not want to really leave their jobs and join a new organization. They're very insecure. So I think that this transformation has taught everybody a lot of things. And thank you.
We are continuing to learn.
We all, I think that we all.
Right. Thank you, Amit. Thank you, Avtar.
But again, thank Chitra, Avtar, Sunil, Divya for a lovely participation in this session in terms of...
The comments which are coming in are overwhelming everybody. Events, delightful yes. Session. They are complimenting, you know, particular aspects about all of you and insights that they are actually going to take away and implement in their roles, responsibilities and organizations. And some of them who are actually CEOs who've joined us here, they are actually messaging me on the side and telling me that they are going to implement these strategies in their organization. So you've made this weekend very, very fruitful for a lot of people, and more than 100 lives we have touched together. Thank you so much. I'm going to quickly deploy a 1 minute poll here for everybody to participate. Speakers, if you have time, please do participate. If I know we have exceeded because of the engagement coming in from the audience. If you have to drop off, we will surely understand. It's just 3 questions. I'm going to be launching the poll. It is live. If you all can participate, this helps us kind of, you know, pick up inputs for our next masterclass. Our aim here is to make all of us a better version of ourselves. And it is, again, like many of our leaders and industry panel speakers today said, that it is not at all dependent on the hierarchy or positions. It is completely dependent on your own self capacity to take initiatives and become a change agent for your organization, for your company, for your family. So my request to you is that become a change driver yourself. Don't wait for somebody to come and inspire you. We have the hacks, we have the know-how. And I'm sure if speakers can give me a thumbs up, I can encourage the audience to connect with all of you on LinkedIn, the professional network. Please feel free to write to us at the Advanced Learning Institute if you have specific queries. We'll be happy to send that list to the speakers and get them specifically answered for you to implement in your organization. Thank you so much. Thank you, speakers, for being with us here and spending this time on a weekend. We really appreciate it. I'll be sending the recording shortly through an YouTube channel to all of you that you can share with your loved ones and your colleagues.
Thank you. Bye-bye. Good to catch up with you guys. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone. I still see more than 50 participants here, so I'm going to continue engaging with you guys. Well, Amit and I are here. Amit, brilliant session. I've got goosebumps right now because I'm very happy to learn a lot.
Likewise, Divya. It is, I think that it is one of the best sessions that I've so far attended. And I think that we have a brilliant team of panelists with us, and you being an excellent moderator. So, and of course the audience. So I think there's a lot of participation that I could see from the audience, and that's something which is really encouraging.
Right. Absolutely. So thank you, everyone. Have a great weekend ahead and keep becoming better versions at the Advanced Learning Institute, powered by Forethought Corporate Communications and Elements HR. I'm your host, Divya Jaitley, driving this point home of taking the lead and taking the initiative of actually making that difference to each of our lives and contributing to our organization as well. So once again, on that note, I would like to sign off and wishing you a very, very good, safe, happy, healthy times. And we will be back again with probably some more input, some more interesting topics. And I'm sure you've given us your recommended topics that you would like to see in the next masterclass. Have a good time. Stay safe. Keep smiling. Thank you.